Guys, welcome back. Welcome to my channel. If it's the first time you're watching my videos, thank you so much for joining us. So my channel is dedicated to my IVF journey, and I've documented all along since we started our IVF in 2021, the journey so far. So some good news: we fell pregnant in 2021, which was just amazing. However, we had a miscarriage on week 11, which was very sad. In my previous video, I kind of explained how we dealt with the miscarriage and where we are so far. So today, before we continue, please guys, just subscribe to my channel and you'll be notified every time I upload my videos about what we are doing on the stages of IVF and what we are doing. And please subscribe and press the like button at the bottom of the page, just so that, you know, we can get going with this channel. So pretty much what I want to say today was, in my previous channel I told you we met with our fertility doctor after our miscarriage, and for those who have done IVF before, you know there's different stages, and for those who are just about to start, so I'm just gonna explain. So with IVF there's two stages. There's stage one, where we call stimulation phase, so where you get the doctor, you're given medications to stimulate the follicles, so that you could produce eggs, you know, mature follicles, and inside the follicles there is a mature eggs, and those eggs are very crucial for creating an embryo. So there is that phase, and then there is the second phase where after you've made the embryos, if you've got spare embryos, they are frozen, and so if the first transfer if it didn't work, then you go into another phase where we call the frozen embryo transfer. So the embryos that were frozen on the first instance after you created them, they were frozen. You're gonna have a different protocol to allow the body, to prepare the body for your frozen embryos transfer. So for me, we had already done our first phase in March, February last year. We did the stimulation phase, so we managed to get 7 eggs were retrieved. Out of 7, all of them were fertilized, so we had 7 eggs, 7 fertilized, and then they were grown in the laboratory up to day 5. We lost 3 on day 3, which they say is very normal. You tend to lose embryos as you go along, and they culture them until day 5. So at day 5 we had 4 embryos in total. We had one transfer in around, I think it was April, May last year, which they call a fresh embryo transfer. We were not successful with that. That didn't even stick, so that was a bit disappointing. And that was our most they said it was 4AA, so they grade the embryos into different grades. So that didn't stay. And then we had 2 months in between then, and then we started our preparation for the frozen embryo transfer, which happened in August last year. And we were so lucky, and we were so excited we were pregnant, and that was amazing news, just taking that pregnancy test and seeing positive pregnant and everything. That was just beautiful. So we carried that for 11 weeks, and at 11 weeks we had a miscarriage. Anyway, so fast forward, so we met with our fertility doctor just before Christmas, and because I was turning 40 last year, the idea was to kind of prepare me for another stimulation phase, just because with fertility, we all know the older you get, your eggs become, the quality of your eggs rapidly goes down. Pardon me. So my doctor said it's best for me to do another retrieval, so the stimulation phase, and get more eggs so that we can batch them together. And then because we didn't do what we call the PGTA testing, So for those who are new to this, PGTA means they test before implantation. So the embryos that you formed, they will biopsy the embryos before freezing them and then sending them to genetics laboratory where they're able to see if there is any abnormality with the embryo. So because we didn't get a chance to do that with our first cycle, all our four embryos were not genetically tested. So we don't know if that's what's causing the miscarriage. So the idea was for us to do another cycle of stimulation so we could form more eggs, and then wherever the embryos we get from this phase, we are going to add with the two embryos. So far, remember we had four embryos, we've transferred two, we are left with two. So we're going to add the two that were frozen plus the two plus any other embryos we're going to make from another retrieval that we're going to do to send them for genetic testing. And up to six embryos in our clinic costs 1,500. So we wanted to do that, but because when we signed up to do IVF, we went via what we call a company called Access Fertility. That's how, I mean, when we registered with with our clinic, they gave us two options. We could either go with Access Fertility or you go direct via the clinic or pay them directly. But going via Access Fertility felt a little bit, it felt like a good, but a good, what can I say, like a good thing, because the price in how Access Fertility worked out looked like going with them, you're able to get two cycles of IVF, so pretty much two stimulation phase and all the embryos that you get out of those. While going via the clinic, you were going to pay each cycle individually, and it kind of worked it out just to be a little bit expensive. So we went with them. So little did we know, we thought once we've paid Access Fertility with two cycles, we should be able to do anything and anything we want to do. So remember, we've done our first cycle. We've had the four eggs. We are left with two. We wanted to do another cycle and make more eggs. However, Access Fertility have a protocol. I think their procedure is more like you're not allowed to move to another stimulation phase, so making of embryos, before you use all the embryos that you made in your first cycle. So for us, it means that the two embryos that we still left frozen, we can't do another egg stimulation unless we use these two. But remember, we wanted to do another egg retrieval just because we wanted to batch the two from this side and whatever we get from this side to send them for genetic testing, because 1,500 up to six embryo, we thought that would be a good chance for us to do that. So we can't do that. And so now we've just decided we're gonna do a frozen embryo transfer. So instead of doing the egg retrieval, we're just gonna go ahead and do the frozen embryo transfer. And that is scaring me, guys, because we've not tested and we've lost two. And I'm just worried because, you know, I don't know what the fate is gonna be, but that's what we're gonna do. We're just gonna trust God and trust in the science and hope for the best. So with our frozen embryo protocol, before we do that, we decided we are going to do a little bit of more investigation just to see what could have caused the miscarriage. If we can get to the bottom, what could have caused the miscarriage. And so some of the tests my doctor advised are like, just a second, let me show you. So there's two tests that we're gonna do in this cycle. One is called ALIS. I don't know if you can see there. So ALIS is analysis of chronic endometritis. So ALIS, what ALIS means is pretty much they're gonna analyze the endometrium to see if there is silent. So sometimes you can have silent chronic endometritis that causes inflammation of the endometrium that could cause miscarriages. So we're intending on doing that analysis. And then there's another one called Emma. Emma, pretty much, sorry, my name is Emma, and that's just bizarre that there's a test called Emma. So means endometrial microbiome metagenomic analysis. That is Emma. And what Emma does is, Emma just looks for the balance of bacteria, the good and the bad bacteria in your endometrium. So, because they said, we all have bacteria, as we all know, but the balance has to be the correct balance for them to function well. So if there is more bad bacteria in the endometrium, it causes inflammation. If there is more good bacteria, it just kind of balances everything out. So inflammation is the biggest problem in an endometrium that can cause A, lack of implantation, and B, miscarriage. So we decided to do these two extra tests before we jump into a frozen embryo protocol. And so I had my Emma and Alice done last week, Thursday. And it's a very, very quick procedure. You go in within 10 minutes. It's pretty much like doing, if anyone of you has done smear test, it's pretty much like doing smear. So they go in and they just scrape through a bit of lining of the endometrium and they send it to the lab. So the doctor said it would take at least, I think 10 to 14 days before it comes back. So what happens next? So after we've received our results from the Emma and the Alice, depending on what the results are going to be, and trust me guys, I think as human beings, there's always going to be something that's not right. So we think we are going to be on antibiotics. So they will give you antibiotics to just calm the inflammation down. And I think another one was more on probiotics. So probiotics helps to kind of level the bacteria's in your endometrium, kind of just give good bacteria more than the bad bacteria. So that will be 10 extra days of doing the antibiotics and probiotics. And then from there on, I think, I'm not very sure if the doctor is just gonna go ahead. I think depending on the severity of the results, she might decide to do another test just to check and see if the medication has worked. And or they might just decide, okay, we know by taking this amount of antibiotics, it will have kind of reduced the damage by this amount. I'm not very sure. I'll keep you updated about that. So after that, that's when we're gonna know when we're gonna have our frozen embryo protocol sent to us. But originally, the nurses had sent us the frozen embryo protocol, and it was exactly the same as our last frozen embryo protocol, pretty much. I didn't want to change anything because that gave us a positive result. And with that, it was just, we included, so we were on Bruxellin. So Bruxellin is like a down regulator, kind of just down regulates your hormones. So during that period of, as you all know, once you've had a period, your endometrium will go through the process of the follicle-stimulating hormones being produced kind of for ovulation to take place. So what Bruxellin does, Bruxellin kind of down-regulates that, kind of holds that. We don't want the follicle-stimulating hormone to be produced because at this point we don't want you to ovulate. So that kind of suppresses it. So I think I'll be in Bruxellin for, I think last time I was on 15 days. And then after taking Bruxellin, that's what they call down regulation. After taking the Bruxellin, I think we're going to move into estrogen. So estrogen is more to pump up your endometrium, to kind of make the endometrium into trilaminar layers, which we know is very crucial for implantation. It has to be trilaminar. And it has to have reached a certain level of thickness before they can allow you to transfer. So that's what the estrogen pills would do. I can't remember how long you're on estrogen pills, but I'll show you guys once I get the schedule. And then from there, they'll give you what we call progesterone. So progesterone is what is a type of, progesterone is the main hormone that kind of holds the pregnancy throughout. So progesterone will just prepare the endometrium just ready for the embryo to come in and snag in there and allows it to just grow and implant and all stuff like that. So those are the three main ones. But then on top of that, my doctor is just going to readjust my schedule, because that's why they say find a doctor, the fertility doctor that kind of makes, kind of designs your treatment according to you. So for me, because of history of preeclampsia, we are always going to be on aspirin. So we're going to take aspirin, I can't remember from what day. And then we are going to be on anti-clotting medication. So my last frozen embryo protocol, we were on what we call Fragmin. But this one, I kind of saw that they gave us Clexane. I think Clexane and Fragmin are the same. They are the same. They do the same thing, but of course, just different manufacturers, something like that. So we're going to have to be on that for a period of time. Last time I was on Fragmin up to around week 10, and then they made me stop. But aspirin, you continue with aspirin all along when you're pregnant. So I'll let you guys know how everything goes. So right now we are waiting for those results. Once we've got the results, I'm gonna do another video just to update you what the results are and how long I'm gonna be on antibiotics. And then from there, the ball will be rolling and I will be moving to the frozen embryo protocol. I'm a little bit nervous, I'm a little bit scared because we've not done the PGTA. So for those who don't know what that means, and for those who are just starting this journey, it is important for you to just ask your doctor about that. Because for me, honestly, when I started this journey, I didn't watch any other person's video. I was so focused on just doing things my own way. I was so worried of being looking at so many different people's different experiences, and then that was just gonna freak me out. But little did I know, watching someone else's journey could give you, if you can just take one advice from someone and it helps you, then that's a really good thing. So I think for those who are starting, and if you're over 35 years of age, I think they say doing the PGTA testing is just really good because it just gives you reassurance that the embryos are genetically normal. So you're not transferring every time you're transferring, you're having a miscarriage and all that. But I'm hoping out of our four, because the first one didn't stick, the second one stuck, but of course we had the miscarriage. Out of four, we are hoping at least we have one. At least we have one that is normal. So who knows? Probably the one that is normal is the next one. So they say third time lucky. Fingers crossed. I'm hoping it's third time lucky. So I'll keep you updated on how everything goes. Probably in another 2 weeks. That's why I'll be doing an update of everything coming up in every, depending on how I get the results or what's going on that time. So keep up, keep watching, subscribe. You'll get notification every time I upload a video. And like this video, guys. Like, press the like button below there. And I love you guys. And thank you for coming along with me through this journey. And for those who are about to start IVF, I wish you all the best. For those who are on the journey, let's keep going. Let's keep going. We're going to get there. 2022, the year of success. Thank you, guys. Bye.